आओ। तो गुड मॉर्निंग माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, इट्स अ ग्रेट प्लेजर फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस टू हैव प्रोफेसर ईडी जेमिस, हु विल बी गिविंग द एमिनेंट साइंटिस्ट लेक्चर टुडे, व्हिच इज द फर्स्ट डे ऑफ सीएसआईआर नीस्ट एक्टिविटीज ऑफ एसआरटीपी। एंड प्रोफेसर जेमिस is very well known internationally in academic circles, and he had his roots from a very small place in Kerala. After topping the state level exams with very high honors, he had to travel all the way to Kanpur to begin his master studies, and then he went to Princeton to do his PhD. And during his PhD, he has traveled to other countries. And one of the unique experience that Professor Jemis had is he had lived in the house of his PhD supervisor for a few months when he had to move from US to Germany. And then he worked with topmost people during his PhD, not only with his PhD supervisor, but several Nobel laureates, including Professor Popple. And then he worked with Professor Raoul Hoffman for his PhD. And he came back to India to join University of Hyderabad, a place which is just coming up, as it has attracted extremely eminent people like Professor Jemis. This university has come to the forefront, and he played a very important role, and he stayed there for 25 years and moved to IISc Bangalore on an invitation to become a professor there. When he is about to settle in IISc, he was asked to lead and start a lab in Trivandrum. ISAT Trivandrum, he was the founding director. Professor Jemis is known for building institutes in University of Hyderabad. He has made a world-class CMSD, where he has to take care of every single aspect of building a facility. And he made a tremendous beginning to ISAT Trivandrum. And I don't want to go through all the awards that he had. If I have to tell that which awards he did not get in India, probably I will not have any. So he has all the awards that one can think about, fellows of all the three academies. And more importantly, he has international awards like Pooky Prize in 2016, and a lot of recognitions he had, including Padma Shri. And more importantly, very few people have something during their lifetime as a rule or a concept after their name. Professor Jemis has contributed by a rule which is called MNO rule or Jemis's rules, which are taking way beyond what Waits and Mingus and other people have done in the area of polyhedral carbonates and polyhedral molecules. And this is a remarkable contribution. And within a few years or a decade, this concept has made its entry into textbooks, which all of us are very, very proud. And he's currently holding the Year of Science Chair of SERB. And I always find that I am extremely lucky that we have people who have reached great heights, but still strongly grounded, very sensitive about issues which will face, which are faced by humanity. And when I asked him to give a talk, he has chosen a title on importance of early questions. This SRTP program is to motivate you, and there will be a lot of personal touch And to tell you that those people who have reached great heights are simply like you and me. Only thing is, they probably have gone into a path very early, and maybe they ask the right questions. They have taken the concepts and then they stayed with that. It is not most of the time the intelligence or excellence or talent that makes people what they are at a very high level. It is the passion, it is the attitude, and it is the perseverance, and more importantly, the joy and fun that one has in doing what they are doing. So, my dear friends, COVID is giving an opportunity. It's giving a great opportunity for us to see what is it we can do in these times. I don't think that there is any room for any of us to get depressed because of this situation. This is a challenge that we have in life, and without challenges, there is no life. So as challenge is bigger and bigger, your life will become fuller and fuller. So with these few words, I would like to welcome Professor Jemis and tell you the importance of early questions. Sir, now I request you to start your lecture.
Thank you, Shastri, for this kind words. And let me welcome you all to this unusual event and summer project that CSIR has started. You are indeed the privileged lot, the ones who are sitting in the comfort of your home or office or lab, and the opportunity that CSIR has started is indeed the greatest opportunity that one could have. I would request Dr. Shastri to put on the first slide.
It is already put, sir. First slide is there, so you can move to a second slide. Yes.
Right, but I am not able to. Maybe if Dr. Shastri could remove the video of Shastri, then I can see the slide.
Yes, sir. Now you are able to see. No, we are able to see your slide.
Okay, I have got now. See, now you could see me basically, my picture itself. You could see my picture.
Both the slide as well as your picture.
Okay. Now let me go to the first slide and tell you that it is very important. It is very important that that CSIR, with its more than 40 research laboratories, have taken this very, very honorable job of conducting a summer workshop in what appears to be difficult times. But this is indeed a great opportunity to have a large number of young enthusiastic students from across the country to be brought together in this platform and have a training program which is conducted online most of the time, and learn from it, learn from each other, and do an unusual advantageous position during this difficult time. Now, I would have this as a very informal talk, and the advantage or the privilege that I have is to be able to talk to the best and the brightest of the country, the young people who is going to make a difference in the years to come. And this is really what makes it so very exciting to me. It is possible for me to talk about formal research projects that I have done from the beginning, but I have chosen to talk about what I have learned as a student, what I have taken from my colleagues, from my classmates, from people that I have met later on, and decided that the best way to talk about all of this is through a title, Importance of Early Questions. So let me come to this importance of early questions. You know, questions is really the essence of innovation, and the talk is in general arranged as, you know, I might say a few words about CSIR and then about questions in general and the nature of questions, whether they could be interdisciplinary, multi or cross and so on. And I may give just one example at the end from my own research, and that's probably all that I have time. Now, CSIR is doing a great job in getting all of you in one platform and allowing you to learn from each other, allowing you to learn from people across the country. This kind of an experiment has never been done because we had specific research summer schools where 30 people will go to one place or 40 people will go to one place. But here is an opportunity made out of an adverse situation by CSIR. And I give full credit to the CSIR, the Director General, and Dr. Shastri, I mean, Dr. Mandye and Dr. Shastri of NIST in Jorhat for having organized this. And Government of India, of course, funds this entire program and expects that the best and the brightest will learn from it, ask questions that lead to innovations, and that would give a comfortable life for the whole of our citizens. Now, I talk about questions, and these are questions coming out of my experience. Questions that that really should be asked all the time, not just when we have adversity. In fact, we say success of nations depends on the ability of its citizens to ask original questions. Questions that are not asked by others, questions that would improve our situation, questions that would improve the life of our people, questions that will advance science, questions that would make India the number one nation in science, technology, engineering, innovations, everything. So questions is critical. And questions is not the monopoly of genius. You know, the bright people may ask questions, the brightest may ask questions, but one need not be the brightest person to be able to ask questions. This can be trained, and it has to be trained from the very beginning. The earlier, the better. Because I have noticed that questions that we ask when we do not know much tends to be very general. For example, if I am asking a student of PhD who is just completing his thesis to tell him, look, formulate some very, very interesting research project, chances are that he will fall back onto the specialization that he has taken. If he is in organic synthesis, he would worry about a synthetic organic chemistry project. If he's in, say, theoretical physics, he might talk about the latest project that he can do in theoretical physics. But if you were, or in his area, whatever that is. But if you ask a beginning graduate student, somebody who is just joined for PhD in physics or biology or chemistry or any subject, and ask him, what would you like to do? And chances are that he would talk about a very general project in that subject, whether it is chemistry, he will not normally restrict to physics, physical chemistry or inorganic chemistry or organic chemistry. But it is even better if you ask a beginning undergraduate student. You know, a beginning undergraduate student, he has just joined the university and, you know, have taken physics and chemistry, for example, and asked to formulate a project. You know, it could be from any of these general areas, but it gets even better if you go to a high school student. For him, all of science is there to be asked, and the questions become very general. And this is really the the crux of it. We have to learn to ask questions even in school as we start growing. And that habit has to begin, and it helps. It helps in many ways. Now, questions in school is very, very interesting, because if one is going to the 6th or 7th or 8th or 9th class and ask a question, chances are that the answers that we get are far more general, far more ingenious than what we would get by asking the same general question in a class of PhD students or even for specialized researchers. I give one example, which, you know, every year I go to a different school on the science day and ask questions to the 8th and 9th class. I mean, the reason I'm able to ask the questions to the 8th and 9th class only is that, you know, on the science day in February, the 10th class is all very busy, and the teachers are spending time with the 10th class students more. And they are happy to have 1 or 2 hours of the 8th and 9th class students kept free. Now, I would just give one example. In fact, you know, if one looks around and have the habit of asking questions, one can ask questions to improve anything that one finds. Anything that one finds in a home, in a school, in class, in road, in any context. In other words, innovative questions is not the monopoly of one or two people, the trained people, PhDs. It is possible to ask such questions everywhere. Now, I ask one question showing this picture of a flush tank that is there in the toilet. You know, you go to the toilet and then you press a lever and then water comes, and then you worry about how to save water. And I have asked this question in the 8th and 9th class. I have tried it also amongst teachers who have come for training. And I find that in 15 minutes of just probing around, the best answer comes from the 8th and 9th class. A similar answer will come from the more specialized group, people who have learned a lot more, but it takes time. Since we are in the distance mode, I'm not trying this experiment, but I'm only telling you the answer that I get very quickly from 8th and 9th class. The answer is that ultimately they give this. It takes about 15 minutes of probing. What else can be done? What else can be done? What else can be done? And somebody comes with this idea. The idea is that the top of the lid of this flush tank, turn it around and make a hole in it and make that as a wash basin, right? Essentially, you press the lever after using the toilet, the water comes through and falls in the top wash basin, which has a hole, and that takes the water to the flush tank so that you can use the flushing next time. So this is simple. But, you know, a question like this can be asked on anything, and chances of someone trained to ask questions would be the first to get such an answer. Now, these questions could be in any area. One doesn't have to restrict. I just gave a simple example of 8th and 9th class that I have tried out. But it could be in areas which involve many, many different subdivisions. You know, it's important to look back why this happens when one is young. You know, when civilization started, when civilization itself was young, questions were, you know, very general. You know, the same scholars did everything. Whether it is Aristotle or Aryabhatta, they did not restrict themselves to one topic, not just to mathematics or physics or social sciences or humanities, even before such subdivisions came. They did everything. I mean, even later on, I mean, even as early as Newton, you know, whether it is mathematics or physics or economics, he was in there. In other words, when one doesn't know a whole lot, or when one is not confined by the barriers of different divisions, we tend to ask more general questions, more deep-rooted questions. Of course, increase of knowledge have brought in the inevitability of specialization. We have natural sciences, which went into then, you know, physics and chemistry and biology, and that led to further divisions. Chemistry, for example, went into inorganic, organic, physical, and organic went into further subdivisions. But those who overcome these barriers, those who go above these barriers, tend to do better things. Now, I tend to talk about what I have experienced. And so this is a highly specialized talk. I talk about places where I studied and people that I have met. It is not as though other examples are not there. So it is, you know, what we do in life in the next moment is decided by everything that one has done till that moment. So this is important. You keep in mind that you do whatever is the best at a given moment, so that what you do in the next moment is even better. This consciousness should be there. You learn from people that you meet. You learn from events that you have attended. You learn from the experiences that you had. And I'm going to talk from that point of view. Now, I talk about a classmate, somebody who joined along with me for PhD. For an undergraduate study, actually, a mathematician who became a biologist. You know, he was an undergraduate specializing in mathematics and went on to do a PhD in Oxford as a Rhodes Scholar, continued in mathematics for some more time, and then thought, well, this is not what he wanted to do full time. Not exciting enough. I said not exciting enough, and that's very important. We should try to do what is the most exciting thing that one can do. If one doesn't like what one does, one should look around to see whether one can do better. In fact, if one can do what one likes to do, that's the very best that one can happen. And this is not, of course, possible for everybody. Now, this mathematician decided, well, okay, I have studied mathematics, but I want to go beyond. And when genomics came up, he went into biology. And in a big way, he became an expert. So much so that by the beginning of this century, when the Institute of Genomics was started by MIT and Harvard, Eric Lander, this mathematician turned biologist, became its first director. So this, you know, this is just telling you that you can start with mathematics and you don't have to stick with it. Any subject you move around, you have to really look around, make an interdisciplinary approach to anything that one does. We have a problem. Our problem is that when we come to BSc or BA or BTEC or BCom, we just are presented with a box of one kind or the other. You know, if you are in engineering, you are given, okay, you have to decide at the beginning whether you are taking electrical engineering or computer science or whatever else. And this is to change. It is very difficult to imagine that all top rankers of JEE would have only interest in computer science. It just not statistically realistic to imagine that. Unfortunately, the setup that we live, the constraints that we are turned to or subjected to right from the beginning, puts us all in boxes early on, even from birth. I mean, you know, it is division by gender. Oh, if you are a girl, you do this. If you are a boy, you do that, and so on. We have to come out of this. In education, the same thing is true. You know, there are smaller steps being made, like in ICER, you can come and start learning mathematics, physics, chemistry, biology, and so on. And then after a couple of years, decide what you want to do. But that is just a very tiny step. Our programs in, you know, UG programs have to really make changes. It is true everywhere. I mean, things are, you know, changing slowly. But maybe COVID has given us an opportunity to think afresh. Now, I talk about, you know, we have the CSIR summer training project for science, engineering, technology, and so on. We should not even leave out humanities and social sciences because it gives you a grounding, but it is also possible to shift from one to the other. I talk about a very unusual situation. You know, when I was starting PhD, a student who was largely studying history joined along with in our year to do physics, he said he wanted to change. He wanted to change from history to physics. And it's very interesting why he wanted to change. He said, well, a historian looks at the past. How far behind in time? How far in the past that a historian can look at? And he found that, yes, there is a limitation, right? A few millennia. But if you want to look at even before, maybe you can go into other, the history of or geology and so on. But if you want to go before, then he realized that, yes, you know, when you go to time that is really close to zero of the beginning of the universe, he may have to only study physics to understand it. So a historian came, and he not only studied the beginnings, he studied the beginnings, and in the process of studying the beginning in terms of theoretical physics, he had to develop so much of mathematics that he got a Fields Medal in mathematics, a historian turned physicist. I'm talking about Edward Witten, who started string theory. He started as a history major. So these are unusual events which we should not just ignore. It is possible. It is possible to start from where one is and think about other things. So even if you are studying X, Y, or Z, keep an open mind. Maybe there are other things that you would like to do. You are better off doing it. But of course, there is a caution. A romantic idea of the origin of the universe or the origin of life should not take one to theoretical physics or biology if one is not having the inherent abilities to do this. So one has to also find what is it that one can do best. Right? This is important. But while doing it, it's also important to keep an open mind. I go back to the same the graduate school experience that I have. When I was getting my PhD degree, there is, of course, the convocation equivalent, which many universities call as commencement, the convocation. And at Princeton, during the convocation, there is something very unusual happened. What is that unusual happens? The best undergraduate student is selected as a valedictorian who could speak 3 minutes about his experience in the convocation. It's a good system. The best student is given a chance to say what he wanted. And the year I graduated, there was a valedictorian who talked about his experience at Princeton. What he said, when he came to Princeton, he saw squirrels. They were all black. And he was sure that all squirrels are black in Princeton. But as years went by, when he was graduating in the fourth year, when he was talking in this platform, giving this valedictory address, he pointed and said, look, here is a squirrel that I see. And the only thing I can say about that squirrel now is that that squirrel on this side of it at this moment is black. Everything else is uncertain. In other words, one has to question everything. What one has learned in this is that one cannot and should not generalize quickly. This is important. We should ask questions all the time. UG specializations early on is an antithesis to this idea. We will not explore other subjects, but I think we are under constraint and we have to still think that, yes, I have taken this subject, but maybe with time, if I don't like it, I will shift. I talk a little more about this idea of being a little uncertain about things. Since I didn't get better words, I will read out Bertrand Russell's, a few lines. The man who has no tincture of philosophy goes through life imprisoned in the prejudices derived from common sense, from the habitual beliefs of his age or his nation, and from convictions which have grown up in his mind without the cooperation or consent of his deliberate reason. Not just by seeing things that have been around, but by thinking of the process. If one doesn't do that, to such a man, the world tends to be definite, finite, obvious. Common objects rouse no questions. and unfamiliar possibilities are contemptuously rejected. Philosophy certainly cannot tell us everything as an answer, but at least it can tell what are the possibilities and enlarge our thoughts and free us from the tyranny of custom. Now, when civilizations were young, questions were general. When we are young, our thought processes are less influenced by what is already known. Even philosophy has not influenced us. So we should be thinking, we should be asking questions, and it doesn't have a definite format. And now I go to just one example or two examples. One is a very common one that we celebrated last year, and that is the periodic table of the elements. You know, the world celebrated it last year, and it's one of the best examples of asking questions. Asking questions by looking at elements, actually in 1869, only 59 elements were known. From that 59 elements, is there anything that we can do? And one only knows the mass. It was before subatomic particles, it was before electrons, protons, and neutrons were discovered. And yet, the question could be asked. And what you see on the screen now is the struggle that Mendeleev had. He had written down the elements, tried to organize it in many, many different ways. Then you can see beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen. And then he has gone to the right, carbon, silicon, boron, aluminum. Maybe there is something else here. And so on, you know. So he thought, maybe this is the way to organize. And when it didn't fit, he said, well, maybe there is something missing. You know, this is asking questions with available data. One should not wait for complete data to begin asking questions. One should start right away. You know, many, many institutions and organizations celebrated it. You know, last year, the periodic table of the elements. I used to talk about this last year, but I do not spend much time today. But this is an example where a questioning mind early on could do many things. Now, often we need to ask qualitative questions, and perhaps answers may come from several quantitative questions and those answers put together. Right? General understanding then allows one to make a framework. Now, an early question of mine, and a question of mine that I asked when I was a first year BSc student. It was an innocuous question, a question that was not asked in an elegant way. The class was going on of first year BSc in chemistry, and I asked this question. This was the time when Cotton and Wilkinson's Advanced Inorganic Chemistry has just come out, and the teacher was, an excellent teacher at the university college. He did not have a PhD, but it didn't matter. He talked about the periodic table of elements, and then he was describing the structural aspects of carbon. He said tetrahedral carbon, methane, ethane, cyclohexane. You can condense them and you can make diamond. Excellent. You know, the structural correlation was beautiful. We can take benzene, put them together, naphthalene, anthracene, and then, of course, infinite sheet, which is, which I call graphite those days. Now, of course, we know that it is sheets of graphene stacked together is graphite. And in the process, we had all this aromaticity and so on. So this was what he talked. And I thought it was excellent. And I, without thinking much, in a rather crude way, asked, is there anything like this for boron? That was all that I asked. And Mr. Sangarayar, Professor Sangarayar said, let us look at this. And we looked, Cotton and Wilkinson was the big deal there. And it was not there. We can't see a correlation between compounds of boron and structures of elemental boron. But we could do that for carbon, benzene, naphthalene, anthracene, and we get to graphite, ethane, and so on. And you fill in the structures with only tetrahedral carbon, we have diamond. So this was a question that I kept in mind, and I asked this question again in IIT Kanpur when I was an MSc student. Professor P.T. Manoharan said, well, you know, these are the two inorganic chemistry teachers we had. Professor P.T. Manoharan said, well, you know, in the course I can give you something about boron compounds for a project, but the answer is still not known. I didn't leave the question, but went on anyway. Joined for PhD, completed the PhD, and you know, with a topic that was suggested by PhD supervisor, because question of boron structure and so on was still more complex. Most of it hadn't still arrived on the scene in forms that can be easily understood. So the relationship between compounds of boron and elemental boron still was missing. Now, I kept talking about this more because one should not leave one's question. Now, here is something that I want to talk about for just a couple of minutes. You know, the PhD final public oral exam defense at Princeton. You know, in the PhD defense, we do not have to defend the thesis. That's interesting. You know, we don't defend the thesis because there is a thesis exam board, and the exam board follows your thesis all through and accepts it. Many of the things are published. So we do not have to defend the thesis there in chemistry department. Instead, along with the thesis, we have to give three research proposals which are not connected with the thesis. And we have to defend these research proposals, and the examination board should accept that, yes, these are reasonable proposals that can be done. The advantage of this is that when you walk out after PhD, you have at least three research proposals which are not of your professor. You have it as your own. And I had three of them, and one of them was, again, something related to boron. It was not possible still to get the solution I wanted, but at least I had three research proposals. It's important to have this. I tell undergraduate students at IASC, when I teach them, I teach undergraduate course, main group inorganic chemistry. And to the undergraduates, when I see them even from the first year, I tell them, ask questions on any topic, in any subject, mathematics, physics, chemistry, biology, doesn't matter. And find out whether those questions had already answers. If those questions did not have answers, note them down in a notebook. Keep adding such ones. And I can tell you, many of these students have 3, 4, 5 page full of important questions by the time they walk out after the 4 years. The habit is important. Otherwise, what happened in this slide, what happened in this slide will happen. We do not have to go and do someone else's project. We should have as many projects as we can have of our own. But those questions can come from early on. Now, let me come back to these questions. I started reformulating these questions over the next, you know, from 68 onwards, I have been doing this at Hyderabad University. I started worrying. I did one of the first projects from there. But till about 2000, I didn't have any idea how the connection can be made. But of course, one cannot just think of one idea and worry about it for 30 years. One will not get a job, one will not make a living. One has to do other things while one worrying about a larger long-term project. So I did many things, many other things. You know, all of these were helpful, but I kept these questions in mind. How do I connect compounds of boron to elemental boron allotropes? And the questions became more and more well-defined as years went by. Even experimental data on allotropes came more definitely and so on. And I would not, of course, go through the great details of this and their process, but I will go through only those details that a plus two student can understand. Right? So from now on, there are extremes of one project, a part of it which can be understood by plus two students. Another part is evolving. It is not done yet. Right? So in this process, I will just give my own experience of doing science. Always emphasizing that one has to start asking questions, right? What is there on the slides is obvious to you, the first part. Benzene to graphene, and you know, I used to call it graphite in my days, but of course, graphene is very important. And stacks of graphene is all that we knew, and we learned how to take layers out. But if you were to take similarly an equivalent of benzene in borane chemistry, it is icosahedral borane dianion. How do we go from there to this? Now, there's a large set of knowledge that has come in, and I will indicate like this. Right here we have in the middle the icosahedral borane dianion. You could of course make alpha rhombohedral boron like this. I don't even attempt to make beta rhombohedral boron because Wade's rule have told us that this is the most stable one. It should be possible to put them together as it is given here. And there are laws of it, rules that are available. And you can see using these rules, how to explain the beta rhombohedral boron, alpha rhombohedral boron, tau boron, gamma boron, so on. Right? These are all published and I'm not going to talk about it. But I'm going to talk about something that is even more recent, something that has come very recently. That is, if one were to remove all the hydrogens from the boron, B12, H12 to minus, if I remove all the hydrogens, then suddenly it becomes flat, totally unexpected. And if one were to make a two-dimensional sheet like this, then something else happens. So this is something that is happening currently, but it is possible for me to explain to you, to a 12th class student, why it is this way. I skip this topic because it takes a talk of its own, the story of why icosahedron. But I will talk about just the icosahedron getting flat, and then of course a flat sheet, which I will call borophene, just as graphene. And you see some holes here, but we will see that. So let us start with the easiest boron to elemental boron connection, just as benzene to graphene. If you remove 12 hydrogens from here, I said it will be flat. And if you want to make, I mean, this is observed by many people. I just list a few of them. But if you were to make a sheet with this in two dimensions, it will be like this, right? All of them triangles. But if you look at this, you know, it's as if we have put one atom in the middle of each six-membered ring in graphene. You know, if you look at this, I've just indicated this more carefully, that you have these things happening, right? So it's as if you have graphene, but in a way that is very close to, I mean, borophene in a way that is very close to graphene. In fact, people have calculated this and find that, you know, the binding energy, that is, if you were to take X number of boron atoms and get this feed, what is the energy that you gain per boron? You know, that is about 6 eV here and in a finite sheet. If you somehow optimize these, you find that, you know, a row of boron go up, another row of boron goes down, and so on. There is some kind of a non-planarity that is coming in. More interesting, if you make some holes, that means remove one boron from here, another one from there, and so on. You remove one out of 9 boron atoms in this, that seems to be even more stable one. Now, this is talking about 2007. We had started getting to these ideas in 2006 with Dr. Prasad, who is currently a faculty member at IIT Kanpur. He was a PhD student with me. We were looking at this in the context of magnesium boride and what we called as borograph. But then we didn't go too far because I decided to shift from Bangalore and start ICER Trivandrum. So from 2008 to 2013, I was away from this field and I thought everything is done. But when I came back and I got a new student, I said, look, all kinds of things are coming out, you know, different hole densities, and this borophene seems to be not understood so well. So what we did was we looked at all such sheets where there is zero hole density, and I have now calculated them all using the same method. Borophene sheet with a zero hole density, that is not the most stable one. 1/9 hole density, as was seen earlier, is the most stable one. 0.0 indicates the most stable arrangement. If you have no holes, It is 92 milli electron volts higher. If you have more holes also, it is higher. And these were all calculations using a particular method. I don't discuss this. And how do we understand this? Now, understanding means different things to different people. Some people want insight and not numbers. We say insight and numbers. Wigner used to say, look, you can model it using a computer, but maybe the computer understands it. I want to understand it as well. So there has to be a model. In fact, any accurate quantitative model should have some realistic way of understanding it. For example, we could have all these great measurements made and make a kennel that is not appropriate for the dog. So we have to really be careful. I mean, this is absolutely essential. So what do we do with this? You know, when we were looking at it in 2013, it was a curiosity. But in the last 5 years, these things have been made, borrowing sheets on metal surface. So it's all the more important that we understand this. And how do we understand the idea that 1/9 hole density is needed? Now, I go back very quickly to some earlier studies, but I skip many things to come to something that is understood by plus two students. Okay, magnesium boride. You know, magnesium boride is like graphene. The only difference is, if you can imagine graphene, you know, all are carbon atoms. But if I were to replace all carbon atoms in graphene by a boron minus, which is isoelectronic, so I have a graphene made of boron minus. But, you know, it is in a boron minus graphene, it is infinitely charged. But what could be done, as is found in magnesium boride, is that for every 2B minus, if you can add an Mg plus 2. So we have a layer of graphene made of B minus and another layer of Mg, which is actually Mg plus 2. I mean, formal charges I am talking, they are not always or never Mg plus 2 and B minus. But this would be like graphene, right? MgB2 will have layers of borographene, that is B minus, and layers of Mg alternating. Now it's interesting that this is superconducting at 40 degree Kelvin. In fact, Akimitsu shocked the world in 2000 with this observation. And many more things are done in this. But how am I bringing this here in the case of borophene with no metals? Let us look at this more carefully. The MgB2, if I were to replace all Mg by boron, right, then it becomes BB2, right? Whether this boron is replaced, obtained from replacing magnesium or from this, they're all boron. Mg was of a different size. It was a different layer. But when Mg is replaced by boron, all of it collapses. When it collapses, we of course have the borophene. All of them are in the same layer, right? But we realize one thing. You know, if you have replaced, I have taken three times this, we have replaced 3 Mg by 3 boron here, B3, B6, just three times this empirical formula, B3, B6. The difference between magnesium and boron is that every boron has an extra electron, right? So if you have replaced 3 Mg by 3 boron, we have 3 electrons extra here, right? If you want to go back to the original electron count of graphene, which is of course a very stable system, if you want to have that, then we have to remove 3 electrons. How do we remove 3 electrons? The 3 extra electrons can be removed by removing 1 boron out of this 9, right? We remove 1 boron out of this 9, and that means we have only 1 boron missing out of 9. We have the 1/9 hole density. It is that trivial, right? You easily find that you can explain this without much of a difficulty. So all that is done in explaining this is that we realize MgB2, which is similar to graphene, would have a boron equivalent if you replace all Mg by boron. And if you replace all Mg by boron, we have the borophene sheet. But then for every 3 Mg that is replaced, we have 3 extra electrons. And in this molecular, I mean, in the empirical formula that we have 9 boron atoms, we have 3 additional electrons. And these 3 additional electrons can be removed by just removing one boron atom. So for every 9 boron atom, if you remove one, we have the whole density, which is 1/9, which is what is found. Nothing very spectacular when you look at it, right? I mean, anybody who knows about the structure of graphite should be able to understand this. But, you know, if only one asks this question, how do you understand it? We get to this answer. But then something more happened. You know, I said all these experiments are available. These experiments are available, but what is the experiment that is done? The initial experiment was to take a silver 111 surface, a very clean silver 111 surface, and we deposit individual boron atoms on it. And then look at the structure of the distribution of the boron atoms on the surface using scanning tunneling electron microscopy. And when you find that, you find that, of course, there are more holes than 1/9 hole density. What we did was then we computed the boron layers on silver 111 surface, and suddenly one finds that what was the most stable one that we had as 1/9 hole density as the most stable energy. Suddenly one finds that in the experimental one that we have got, there are much larger hole densities. Why is it? These are computed values, but can we have an explanation? And the explanation is kind of trivial in some sense, because when one have a borophene sheet made on silver, you know, the silver is a metal that has a reasonably low ionization potential and work function, that it would like to I have lost the connection.
No, you are audible.
Okay, right. The slides are on?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, good. So basically, I would skip this, you know, the next of the rest of this with the idea. Hello? Hello?
We are able to see the slides and hear your voice.
Okay, I have somehow lost the slides. I will just get back to the slides. Just a moment. Yes. So this idea is that metal would like to donate electrons, and metal cannot donate electrons if boron doesn't want them. To make boron want the electrons, you need to have even more holes. 1/9 hole density is just perfect in terms of electron count, right? To have more holes, if you have more holes, then the metal can donate electrons and can form a stable layer. Of course, I have approximated many things in this, but this is the basic reasoning that one can have. So I come back to this and say that, yes, a graphene that we make will have, a borophene that we make will have to have holes. And if we can have holes, there is a very interesting advantage. See, graphene, if you want to make graphene electron poor or electron rich, we have to dope with nitrogen or boron. We need to have added electrons or decreased electrons. But if you would like to have similar situation in borophene, we do not have to add another element. We have the facility already. You just increase the number of holes or decrease the number of holes. So borophene presents a totally different system. We say graphene is very sturdy because we have all this sp2 hybrid connections, connected hexagons. But borophene is even sturdier because it has 3 membered connections all across. The electrical, mechanical, conducting, all kinds of properties, magnetic, you know, all of these are just beginning to be studied. So we are at the beginning stages of this exercise. Now let me come back to this general question that we had. You know, how to go from B12, H12, 2 minus to the allotropes. We have other allotropes coming in. We have allotropes that are almost like fullerene, but larger hole. We have, of course, a new allotrope that has just come out in 2017, which is obtained by putting B12s together. You know, I have indicated one. All of these are happenings now in the case of boron. All of these, well, I would say that these had a beginning by Wade when he looked at the Wade's rule of polyhedral borane. We wanted to have three-dimensional ones starting with B12. It is possible for alpha rhombohedral boron, easily understood. For beta rhombohedral boron, we have to start the same idea. Start from benzene to naphthalene to anthracene. We have Huckel 4N plus 2 rule. We have to go from B12, H12, 2 minus to B20, H16 to B30, H24 and so on. And then we get to the beta rhombohedral boron, which is the thermodynamically most stable allotrope, equivalent of graphite in terms of thermodynamics, but in terms of complexity, far more complex than diamond. I would only indicate the nature of the complexity and then stop. The nature of the complexity, you see in the slides, you know, this is almost starting with a B12. We are building other B12s. You know, you have half of a B12. If you look at all of them, you see it's almost like a C60, but it is not a C60. It is an outer layer of B60. You keep going and then you can get to the final structure. I'm not going to go through this because this is a larger project, but the emphasis that I want to bring in is that it all began with just one question in 1968 in my first year BSc. I did not leave it, held on to it. It's important to keep asking questions. As I mentioned earlier, many undergraduate students that I come across in Indian Institute of Science, we have a four-year degree program. You know, I tell them to ask questions, and most of them ask questions that are known, but very quickly they start asking questions of the unknown. But they ask questions which nobody knows often an answer, and that is the key. You can ask questions not necessarily of a subject that is familiar. You can ask questions about everything around. In fact, one could even be a practical, innovative person to say that, yes, how about improving anything that is around me, right? You know, the startups are just the tip of the iceberg. We should have startups in every area, and we should have a approach in learning to ask questions. You know, if you do that, and there are several thousands of you, the youth of this country start asking such questions, you know, we are definitely going to make India as the number one country. We are good in many things, but we are not number one in many things. We have to be number one. If each of you could really put your mind to ask questions, right questions, questions that are out of the box, questions that will ask the questions of this vast people, questions that will, you know, say that, look, I don't want to be labeled just because I'm born in a, you know, in a gender or in a region or in a religion, anything. But I have to ask questions of a particular useful kind, and this has to be developed. It is important to do this. I will stop at this stage. I will, of course, have, you know, lots of good students, bright ones, like any one of you, and help me all the way. And I would thank Professor Shastri and his colleagues at CSIR and EIST and CSIR in general, my colleagues at IAC and other institutions, the government that has funded me all the way, right from the National Science Talent Search Scholarship in 1968. And I thank you all for your kind attention, and I conclude now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your excellent talk, touching upon the most important aspects of a scientist And there are a large number of questions, both in Facebook and in YouTube, as well as MS Teams. And I thank all the audience, which are over 2,500 who are attending this. And there are some questions, sir. Would you like to answer some questions?
Yeah, sure. I mean, you know, it's easy to answer questions that are from the youngsters because they are so tough, and I have to say I do not know, but that's not an issue. At least I can tell you where to look for.
So now the question from Ambarish Raja Deka is, the definition of education is to bring out hidden potential of the students, but our education is based on marks. How can we resolve this problem?
I think we are beginning, and I would say COVID is a situation which has forced the institutions to think again. So I think even though we shouldn't have waited for the COVID to come, but universities are rethinking. I was told that Indian Institute of Science, for example, has made letter grades in many situations. Of course, this is not the ideal waiting period for this. I fully agree that that we should not really depend or decide everything on marks. In fact, many institutions do not. One should give grades, and grades should be a whole range, a running grade, and you know, each one's individual capabilities should be pointed out. In fact, I must say, in this respect, private institutions, industrial organizations, and institutions that are not strictly educational ones are doing better in this. You know, many times industrial organizations don't worry whether you have the first rank. They often ask the question, have you taken apart a cycle and put it together? So there is a different way of judging. Yes.
Thank you. And there is another question, and I know that the answer may be a little bit not straightforward. Abhishek Chattar, he is repeating that his question should be asked. His question is, I would like to ask Professor Jamis that structure of DNA is made by hydrogen bonds, covalent bonds, van der Waal bonds, van der Waal forces, and non-covalent interactions. But how does the blue shifted hydrogen bonds play a significant role in multi-stranded DNA? Abhishek, this is a little interesting question, and I am sure that you can write a mail to Professor Jamis or a copy to me. One of us will reply. If you have a very short answer, because I know that this takes a whole 1 hour lecture.
No, I think the you know, when we say hydrogen bond, it includes blue shifted and red shifted ones. It's just that we have more of the red shifted ones, but there are a few rare examples of blue shifted ones as well. But it comes even more so when we look at some synthetic structures and also enzymes which had some halogen atoms. So it's not as prevalent, the blue shifted ones in hydrogen bonding, as in halogen bonding or any other main group element bonding of the same kind. But yes, details one has to really see. It is more important for, yeah, go ahead.
Good. Abhishek is really reading papers of Professor Jamis. He has made a remarkable paper in the red, blue, or no shift in hydrogen bond, which is one of the highly cited ones. Then a good question by Bindu Jacob. She says that very informative session. Sir, I have a small query. As you said that we need to be multidisciplinary and shift to different disciplines, and based on this, is it okay if we pursue graduation in one area of discipline, for example chemistry, and later change post-graduation discipline to biochemistry?
I think, you know, this is most appropriate if you like it, because it is not really much of a shifting. I was giving you an example of a historian who became a theoretical physicist and a mathematician who became biology. Chemistry to biochemistry is such a small shift. One should boldly shift without any question if one likes it.
Bindu, I would like to say that I did my PhD from Professor Jamis in theoretical chemistry. And out of 22 PhDs who graduated from me, 13 are from chemistry and the remaining 9 are from biology. Now in my group, 90% of the people are from biology doing computer programming. So you have to realize that these fortuitously divided different branches will disappear. And you are absolutely free. You can do PhD in chemistry and work on computer science or mathematics or even history. Maybe the last one is more rewarding, as Professor Jamis said.
And vice versa.
And vice versa, yeah.
Okay.
So Azim Khan has a question that I would like to take computational biology in my master's, but being a biology major, I am facing problems in getting a computational biology course.
No, it depends on the way one has learned mathematics as well. This problem has come up often, even in ICERs in general, because students are taken after plus two into ICER, and often 11th and 12th class already people have left out mathematics. And then they come, start learning, and nothing absolutely impossible about learning mathematics at that stage. So we find that a certain percentage of students in ICERS are taken in the mathematics, physics, chemistry, biology, and all the other sciences program without mathematics in 11th and 12th. And they cope up. It is an effort, but they cope up. So this is something that comes as a barrier, because one probably left mathematics already in the 11th class. My own humble request is that if you have an interest in science, this is not for you, because you have all finished that and reached to BSc and MSc and PhD. But if you can tell your people that if you have an interest in science in 11th and 12th, do not leave mathematics. This is what I would like to say.
Thank you,
so
sir.
So go ahead to mathematics. Yeah, please.
Akshay Joshi has a question. What is the best time to change over, after UG or after PG?
I think, there is no unique answer for this. I tell you, a person that I know so closely, my close relative, started this. He was interested in mathematics and didn't want to shift at all, and joined ICER Pune, and was there for first 2 years doing well in mathematics. And then, he was looking at other subjects and found that biology is as exciting. And by the time third year, he shifted to biology. But I know lots of people who have shifted to statistical physics after BSc in chemistry and MSc in chemistry. So there is no specific time. It just depends on the opportunity and the awareness that you have. So please look around and see what is the best time. There is nothing like one answer for this.
Sir, with your permission, I will take the next two questions myself. That the Abhishek Chhatar is very keen on this hydrogen bonding. He says that how can the NHN hydrogen bonds in non-canonical base pairs of RNA be identified by NMR spectroscopy? Abhishek, we will try to definitely answer you offline. Either you write to Professor Jamis or me, and then we will try to answer. And Priya has a question. This is also for me. Many students did not get reply of their mails. Please tell them that they are selected or not. And again, after 1 minute, she writes, it's creating so much pressure for the student. Priya, please be patient. And we have decided to give this opportunity to everybody. So we are also trying our best. Everyone has limitations, and we will definitely get back to you. Just be patient. Okay. So there are other questions. Again, Priya Rice, kindly inform them via email or on site. We will do this. Don't worry. Just enjoy the lectures and then try to really ask more questions, and then you will definitely be connected. Okay. Sir, Gayatri has a question that you are encouraging interdisciplinary, but for many of our government jobs are not accepting interdisciplinary as a qualification. They reject interdisciplinary even to get guideship for faculties. This is a very important question yes. many people have.
I think you know this question is being addressed by the UGC and the other national educational agencies right now. The best opportunity that we have is actually COVID again, I would say, in this case, because it's time for us to recast our undergraduate education program from putting people in boxes when they begin itself. When we can, you know, unshackle this, when we can break open that boxed idea, you know, of physics with the chemistry and mathematics, or electrical engineering only in the BTech, or you know, and that is decided in the first year, or computer science decided in the first year. Even in IITs, you join in mechanical engineering, and one person might make it to a change, or two, three people to another subject. Or somebody joins in civil engineering, because we have such concepts as to how a major is selected, not according to what one's interest is. But the reverse is also true. People are not sure what is their interest. They go by what the society or the parents or the friends tell. So one has to have a facility provided by the educational system to see things and then decide. At the same time, a governmental setup which agrees that yes, if you have done an MSc in biotechnology and have become an expert in chemistry, physics and biology, you should be admitted to PhD programs in any of these subjects. And a few institutions do that. But I can easily see the dilemma of the questioner, that if you apply for a faculty position in physics, they say, oh, you didn't have an MSc in physics. I think things are changing, but not fast enough. And I'm sure the educational institutions of the UGC or the ICERS or the IITs or all the other AICTU and others would be slowly changing.
Yeah, so it's a good thing. And Gayatri continues to ask a question that say, suppose I am a toxicologist during PhD and wanted to move to drug discovery during postdoc. The recruiters are not considering us. This is also the case of funding agencies. They also don't fund. What is your opinion about these issues? Gayatri, you have to realize that you have to go above these things and then keep on pushing hard for your interests, keep changing. There will be a time where people will be listening to all your things. Make a mark in this. This is my advice.
But Gayatri, it's good that you are asking this question, and these questions will be actually consolidated and given to the funding agencies as well. In fact, some of them are even watching, so that there has to be some interdisciplinary way of looking at applications. We have tried in limited ways in some funding agencies, but in very limited ways. It has to expand a lot more.
There are a number of questions, but I have an interesting question from an anonymous person. His name was not displayed here. He says that, I find it difficult to ask questions like, I don't understand anything, or I know everything. Sir, any suggestion regarding this for improvement?
I think this is the best part. If I don't know anything, it's easy to ask questions. You know, it's like I walk outside the home, and of course, if you are not in the containment zone, that is, you can look up the sky and say, why is the sky blue? Right? Of course, answer to this question is known, well known. But I'm trying to say, if you do not know anything, it's a lot more easy to ask questions. Sometimes so much more difficult questions to ask. If you know everything, of course, there is no need to ask anything. So yeah. I think it's a very interesting stage, and that's why I said when one doesn't know much, it's a lot easier to ask general questions. When one has learned a lot, like in a PhD, somebody who has a PhD, then he or she will be so constrained to ask questions only in the specialized area that that is known to them. So I think you are at a great advantage of not knowing a whole lot, or at a disadvantage of knowing everything. Then there is no question to ask.
Thank you, sir. So there is a question of very interesting question, but for which sometimes you ask a question, you should not wait for others to answer. You try a lot and you will yourself get an answer. So this is a question from Azim Khan, which is in this category, in my opinion. Sir, I wanted to ask Azim Khan's question. I wanted to ask that what causes the irritation of skin after the mosquito bite? How they recognize human beings?
You know, I'm not an expert in this, but I know that the answers are known.
Yeah.
The answers can be found out easily. You know, those are, of course, questions that one should learn and learn the answer as well. But this is something already known. Though I'm not an expert and I can't tell you the answer, I know that it is known and I can give you references that you can find out.
That's why I said that it's very important to ask a question ourselves rather than, because asking questions is very important. And many times we are in a very good stage to answer our own questions if we spend enough time. So there is another person who has a genuine question, maybe very important question, that during project time, that SRTP project time, if he's stuck in exams, will you give excuse during that time? Okay, sure, take your exams. Only when you are in free time, you do the SRTP project. If you have more important things, there will be no constraint. So there are several questions, there are hundreds of questions here, but they are mostly about things which are general type. And in Facebook and YouTube also, we have several questions and we cannot continue forever. And I request my colleague Lucky Saikia to ask a few questions that he is looking at this Facebook, right? YouTube, there are questions. And Lucky will be asking some of the questions to Professor Jermis on your behalf. Lucky.
Good morning, sir. Actually, there is a question from Swayar Talapatra. He's asking that in terms of stability, which is more stable, alpha or beta rhombohedral boron?
Well, beta rhombohedral boron is the most stable from a thermodynamic point of view. But that stability, you know, if you were to take only you know, if you remove the entropy part of it, then the difference is almost zero.
Okay, thank you, sir. So there is one more question from Muruli Krishna Hari. He is asking that which is more useful for energy storage application, graphene or borophene?
See, borophene is just beginning. You know, it was first observed on a metal surface only 4 years ago. It has a lot of promises.
Yeah.
The difficulty is that working with them as a single layer is still a question. Because as a single layer, it has advantage. For graphene, to make it electron rich or electron poor, we have to add other atoms like nitrogen or boron. In borophene, we only have to adjust the number of holes. Then it becomes electron efficient or electron rich. So there are many, many such advantages, and it will take more time to get a borophene sheet. But it is not surprising because the structural chemistry of boron is at a stage that carbon was 100 years ago. I think.
Thank you, sir.
We are marching much faster, but the answer of question, you know, I cannot answer that right now. I mean, chances are that yes, borophene might.
Sir, one more question. So this will be the last question from the student. Yes, Frangere, he is asking that how to ask the right questions, because we in our colleges are trained to learn by just listening to our teachers. So how to ask the right questions? His question,
I think,
is that,
you know, we all go through despite our system in some sense. So, but I think, you know, a teacher may not may not prevent you from asking questions. You know, the question that I asked in BSc in my first year was actually after the class is over and I was walking fast behind the teacher and asking this question. And he listened and he turned around and he said, okay, let us look at it and so on. So, you know, don't think that teachers are not going to listen. It's just that they are asked to push so much more things in one lecture that they have problems. So if necessary, try to approach them even outside. But the government, the education institutions, the UGC are all trying to change the situation where questioning, even in school, is going to be more encouraged.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir.
So there are a large number of questions, sir. Can you answer 2-3 more? I don't know where to stop.
Okay, you look another at your program and tell me when I should stop. I could go on for a few more minutes, not a whole lot more, but
So Priya Pandey has a question that how can one increase these are all young people and they have very interesting questions. How can one increase the knowledge and inevitability of specializations?
You know, I think it is necessary to keep talking to people. You know, if you are in which class are you in, or is there a way that, is there an indication of which class or which BSc or MSc PhD program the person who asked the question is? Okay, what I would say is that talk to your colleagues, talk to your colleagues in adjacent departments, and keep an interest as to what is it that with your knowledge, with your specialization, that you can spread on. In other words, you learn from everybody. So there is no one answer.
Thank you. I think with your permission, I want to say that Priya, you already have done a good thing by joining this SRTP. This is probably one way to increase the knowledge and inevitability of specializations, because here there is no specialization. So on behalf of all of you, we thank Professor Jemis. I know that Navneet Shukla has a question on how do I study the relationship of plant simulations with the climate by using isotopes. Kindly give me direction to initiate. Navneet, this is a good question, and then we have a geoscience and there are large projects which are there, and we have quizzes, we have essay writing competitions, we have asking big questions and big challenge. This is a 2 months program. And all these questions you ask, and then we really thank on behalf of all of you.
I would interrupt and say that even if it is not possible for you to answer all the questions right now, you make a list of all these questions, and at least by the time the summer project program ends, you could get experts' names to whom these questions can be given, and more detailed answers can be obtained, including the last question, which is a very, very interesting one.
Yes. Actually, we already have a plan to collate all the questions that were asked during these programs and then put it in the blog along with the name of a person who asked that question, and then try to see whether a debate can be started. But somehow this is an amazing country, incredible India. You plan for something, you plan for 400 to 500 students, 16,000 students apply. You plan for a dozen questions or so, thousands of questions come. So I mean, that is the strength of our country.
You know, I feel that, you know, with these young inquisitive minds, we have nothing to fear. We are actually going to be number one in everything.
Sir, what is the most important punchline that I see that you are repeatedly making is that our country should be number one. I think COVID has given us a chance, as you said, to reflect upon ourselves and see what are the areas in which we have to strengthen us and make a plan to become number one. And in all these things, you have very clearly mentioned that asking early questions is very, very important. and importance of early question was very, very clearly highlighted, and we are all beneficial to you for your stimulating lecture, sir. So I would like you to conclude this by saying the final 2-3 lines from you. And on behalf of all the team, I am really thankful to you for kindly taking your valuable time with a short notice. Thank you very much. Now it is up to you to.
I take a minute only. What is important in life is to learn from everybody around. What is important again is not so much be detected by failures. In fact, failures teaches us more. And it is also important that, you know, in the long run, it is observed. In the long run, it is observed that everyone gets what they deserve. No more, no less. I'm not trying to say that the world is deterministic. What I want to say is that every day one should live in a way that the world thinks that you deserve more and you will actually get more. Because at the end, it's important that each day you actually make a difference to the world, the people around you. And the people around you will suddenly see, okay, there is a change coming in. So you are the elements of that change, each one of you. And there is a public funded, government funded system that have done this under circumstances that are very unusual. But I think this is the best way in which a bad situation is made into a very, very good one. So do well, stay safe, and think of important questions, interdisciplinary questions, questions that would have a great consequence to us, to our society, to our country, and the world at large. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. I just wanted to bring to the notice of all the people that tomorrow we have the lecture by Professor Dinabandhu Sahu. The lecture is entitled as Indian Expedition to Antarctica, Indian Expedition to the Antarctica Journey of the First Indian Student to the Frozen Continent. This is an exciting lecture that somebody who is again from a small place in Odisha has gone for the first time, a student in a big team who visited Antarctica along with the Indian team. And I hope that all of you will be listening to this lecture. He was the former director of IBST, IMPHAL, and I look forward to meeting you. And there are several questions that you have regarding the project and all. Please visit our website and you will have answers for most of your questions. And if you don't find answers, you wait for some more time and you will eventually get, hopefully by tomorrow morning. Okay, now I thank Professor Jemmis again, and I will be signing off. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you. Namaste.